I'd like to call the June 17th Portsmouth Police Commission meeting to order. We want to thank everyone for coming to this meeting and participating tonight. On September 4th, 2014, when we commissioned the task group headed by Judge Stephen Roberts to investigate the Portsmouth Police Department's handling of the Goodwin Weber matter and issue a report, we said we would release the report in a timely fashion, which we have done. In addition, we said we'll have a separate meeting for public comment on this report, which we are doing tonight. Since the release of the report on June 1st of this year, the commission has met 3 times and will continue to meet, review the findings, and address them. We have not wavered in our commitment to see this through. It would be a discredit to the Roberts report and its authors, as well as the residents, the commission, and police department itself, to rush through the report's recommendations and not do our due diligence as elected commissioners. Amidst the barrage of more than 250 news articles over the past 3 years, there is a temptation for the public to believe it has all the facts. There is a temptation to believe that the action the commission should be taking in response is a no-brainer, and it's not happening fast enough. However, the reality is this was and continues to be a very complex situation. As stated multiple times in the Roberts report itself, in hindsight, different decisions at different way points would have resulted in different outcomes. It is our responsibility to evaluate the information, to seek legal counsel, seek advice, and perform research. I think it bears repeating here that legal counsel and advice have been sought by the commission from the very beginning on this matter. Decisions were not, nor will they ever be made in a vacuum, or be made carelessly, or with the intent to avoid addressing any issue. While the commission must listen to the public and other elected officials, in the end, it's the commission which must arrive at unbiased, substantiated decisions based on verifiable information with input from legal counsel on the consequences of each decision. To keep the process untainted, the commission must only be influenced by the full pool of data and not the incomplete or hand-picked information provided in the media that has at times created public discourse and or political pressure. This is an isolated event within the whole history of the police department. It does not negate the decades of stellar service by police commissioners and staff. Any efforts to use this one issue to paint a global definition of the department, its staff, and its work is irresponsible, to say the least. Yet I fear this is exactly what has happened today, and I speak for the commission on that, not just me. There is distinct coloration of the commission and the department as corrupt, sneaky, and underhanded in much of the headlines and public rhetoric on this matter. The Roberts report simply did not find this true. In spite of this, the commission is committed to fulfilling its responsibilities in a sound, fair, and impartial way, as expected. As stated more than once in Roberts' report itself, the report should be viewed as constructive. It's designed to foster improvement to the operations and morale of the department for the benefit of not only employees, but of also the full Portsmouth community. We said we would release the report in a timely fashion. We've done that. We said we would be thorough in our review, and we're doing that now. We have kept our word in what we said we were going to do. We will not be rushed in this process. Thank you for your time tonight. And before I start the public comment session, I would just like to lay a few ground rules. The public comment session has been dedicated to the Roberts report and will follow the framework of the City Council public comment guidelines. People will be allowed 3 minutes for their comments. If a second round of comments is necessary, we'll be happy to do that. We are committed to making sure everyone who is here speaks. Please confine the focus of your comments to the Roberts report For the purpose of having clear minutes, please state your name and address before beginning your remarks. And all we'd ask is please respect the 3-minute rule. And be happy to have the first speaker come.
Are you going by the list or not?
I'm waiting for that, Joe. Sorry about that.
Oh, so you are going to go by the order of the list?
I would think that would probably be fair. Just bear with us while we get the list. Before I call, can everybody hear us now? I heard you couldn't hear us before. Arthur Cloud, before I call you, I just want to let everybody know that Jerry, Commissioner Howe will be holding up the sign. When there's 30 seconds left, he'll hold that up. And then when your time's over, he'll say thank you. So Arthur Cloud would be the first person to speak.
Arthur Cloud, 431 Pleasant Street. When I last met with the police commission in that rather broad meeting regarding the Roberts report, it was said that the report would go where it led. The Roberts report constrained itself. So under those auspices, I will speak about the investigation. When I got my hair cut by then police commissioner in 2013, he told me many years ago that people from within the police department had asked him to run. So has been the history of the police commission having conflicts of interest. In February 2015, in the middle of this investigation, former Deputy Chief Corey McDonald announced that he had given 6 months' notice to the city that he was resigning and claimed that the commission wanted to replace him sooner than later. Here's what the Herald quotes. But Police Chief Stephen DuBois said the police commission negotiated the severance agreement with McDonald because when he gave notice, he said he'd stay until August. But in the interest of getting the agency moving forward, it was preferable that he'd leave sooner than later. He's got some opportunities, this is Chief DuBois. He's got some opportunities, and I don't want to drag the transition process out any longer than necessary, certainly not for the position, DuBois said. I want to get going on it, but I want to do it in a thoughtful and deliberate manner. McDonald said when the police commission gave him his March 18th end date, rather than accept his suggestion that he stay until August, it triggered a provision in his contract that gave him 6 months severance pay. The provision states that if he's terminated without cause, he's entitled to 6 months pay or the balance of the contract, whichever less. How is it the police commission could pay a severance to somebody resigning while under investigation? There are going to be retirement funding consequences to the taxpayers of the city of Portsmouth. How much is this so-called severance package going to ultimately cost the citizens of Portsmouth? Corey Fuller McDonald's fingerprints were all over the Weber matter, including his solicitation of legal counsel to the benefit of Aaron Goodwin and in contrary to the city of Portsmouth. Does this constitute malfeasance? Has his conduct been reported to the Office of Professional Conduct by the City Attorney's Office? Why didn't Attorney Sullivan represent the financial interests of the City of Portsmouth in the Weber matter? Why did the Roberts report keep using the term command staff rather than using names like McDonald, DuBois, and Schwartz? For those on the commission who are not in favor of disciplining or ejecting the officers who had direct responsibility and were the chain of command, I would guess that they might actually be in favor of disbanding the police commission. Most of us would rather see the commission using these meetings for handing out awards rather than discussing this particular issue. There's been a history of misconduct There's been a history of this police commission not doing it. Randy McQuaid, sexual harassment, sexual assault, from what I can understand, in Washington while on police business, followed by Hoidrat. And apparently, from what I've been led to believe, there was a
Arthur, I don't mean to cut you off, but that has nothing to do with the Roberts report. Please state it at topic.
I am talking about the discipline of police.
That last comment you had, and I don't mean to interrupt you, but that had nothing to do with the Roberts report. You're going off subject. Please stay to it.
I'm on subject because this involves a settlement with McDonald and a female officer.
That has nothing to do, and it's not in the Roberts report.
The Roberts report is censored. Roberts report is censored, and we don't want to be controlled. When I spoke in front of city council, the chief came up to me, and you were sitting next to him, and he brought me out into the lobby and told me I shouldn't be talking about the police department without talking to him first. I am tired of this controlling police department and the controlling. I would like to know if there's any.
Thank you, Arthur. Next is Roland Cody.
Hi, my name is Roland Cody. I live at 188 Union Street. The Roberts report acknowledged two sworn statements under oath. The first one being Sergeant Goodwin swearing that on January 4th of 2011, he informed his then chief of the potential of inheriting a lot of money, the house, etc. The second is a sworn statement by the then chief that said he did not know anything about that until Ms. Weber died, which was something like 2 years later. I think that translates pretty easy. The answer is perjury. One of the two people committed perjury. Perjury is a crime. And I don't know what's going on behind the scenes, but I have a feeling that there's nothing happening in terms of trying to find out which of the two committed a crime. So I'll just speculate that if it happened to be Sergeant Goodwin, that would just add another pearl to his string of deceit, in that if he made everybody believe that his chief approved what was going on, then everybody under the chief could validly say, I wash my hands of this. The chief has spoken. Hail to the chief. It's not my role to question anything. It's my role to carry out orders. So I'll end by saying that in any walk of life, in any industry, stuff happens. As you acknowledge, it's an unusual situation. In my case, I support the police department. I support our current chief. I support the management. It's just that something happened, and it's unfortunate. Thank you.
Thank you, Roland. Next, and I'll do the best I can to pronounce everybody's names. Diane Messier for Bess Mosley.
Diane Messier, 171 Walker Bungalow Road, for Bess Mosley, 302 Springbrook Circle. And this is addressed to the three commissioners. Dear commissioners, I will be out of town on Wednesday, unable to attend the meeting you are conducting at 5 p.m. in the city council chamber. I feel strongly about the Weber-Goodwin matter and the recently released Roberts report, and will appreciate your including this letter in your consideration of the matter. The police department. It is difficult from the outside to identify what has gone wrong within our police department as pertains to the Weber-Goodwin matter. But the evidence is clear that the system we have did not work. I see no way to move our police department and city forward without a clean slate, which would require that Captain Michael Schwartz, Chief Stephen Dubois, and Detective Aaron Goodwin no longer be part of it. I don't know these people, and it is difficult to have to single them out, so I can only imagine how difficult it must be for you who presumably know them personally. Nonetheless, according to the Roberts report, Detective Goodwin violated rules of the police duty manual as well as the city's code of ethics. Further, Captain Schwartz and Chief Dubois were aware of these violations had occurred and did nothing about it. Nor, to my knowledge, have they done anything since to help relieve the city and its police department of the unfolding scandal. Had Detective Goodwin not violated the rules or had his superiors performed their duties and addressed those violations in a timely fashion, none of us would have had to endure these last few years of disgrace, and Mrs. Weber's estate would not have been diminished by years of litigation. Think about the price the city and the police department have paid for the improper behavior of a few. The Police Commission. According to the Roberts report, it is not clear when the Police Commission became aware of Detective Goodwin's behavior or the lack of response from Captain Schwartz and Chief Dubois to that behavior. It is therefore impossible to assess whether the commission acted appropriately, but I think it is clear that it was at best ineffective. Based on last night's City Council meeting, it seems that the future of the Portsmouth Police Commission is uncertain, but this is your moment to do the right thing, a very difficult thing. The citizens of Portsmouth and, I suspect, the majority of its police officers will be grateful for your courage and fortitude. Thank you for your service. Very truly yours, Bess Mosley. Thank you.
Thank you, Diane. Next is Jane Zill.
Jane Zill, 27 Shaw Road. And Chairman Gollum, I have to disagree with you. I do not think the community is thinking that the entire police department is in disgrace. I think the community has identified a few bad players. The Roberts panel based its analysis on PD rules and regulations regarding conduct, whether on or off duty, tending to cast disrespect or disrepute on the department, and the city ethical code when they found Goodwin guilty of 6 violations and serious lapses in all levels of leadership. Although in October of 2014, the panel was told to go wherever the facts and evidence lead, it did not comment on all the evidence that was submitted, including the 2008 New Hampshire Department of Justice publication responding to the needs of the elderly, a law enforcement field guide and resource manual on elder abuse, neglect, and financial exploitation. Clearly, Chief Dubois, Captain Schwartz, who was described by the PD in 2009 as having extensive training in the investigation of child abuse and elder abuse, and Sergeant Goodwin should have been familiar with its contents and realized that the circumstances of Goodwin befriending Weber and becoming the primary beneficiary of her substantial estate were problematic. As the situation dragged on until Weber's death and after, did they ever think to consult state law and realize that the relationships Goodwin and Schwartz forged with Weber were highly questionable? The chief should have and could have intervened many points along the way. The manual specifically lists warning signs of exploitation that include a recent will transfer when the elder seems incapable of writing or understanding such things, the recent acquaintance of a new best friend expressing affection for an elder with assets, and describes the role of the power of attorney as a license to steal. Goodwin was appointed as power of attorney about 6 months prior to the creation of new estate plans. The panel also failed to note that Officer Goodwin went to Weber's bank and represented himself as a Portsmouth police officer as justification to have access to information related to her business with the bank. Finally, the panel did make many recommendations that I truly, truly appreciate, including this one: assessment and reevaluation of the relationship between the police commission, the city attorney, and the police command staff in terms of how critical decisions are currently being handled on a day-to-day basis. The lines of responsibility appear to be blurred and would benefit from formalized policy. I'd like to remind the commission and the public that the city attorney's office supported a plan for mediation that would have allowed Goodwin to receive $425,000 from Weber's estate. This outraged the public, and the public is still outraged. This is a sad time for our city, the officers involved, and their families. Healing cannot occur as long as they remain in the department. I also believe that the best course for the city regarding this matter is to seek independent legal counsel. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane. Joe Onesco.
Good evening, councilors. And Chief DuBois. Yesterday's Portsmouth Herald published a long summary of my many concerns, so I'll be brief. First, let me quote the Roberts panel. We have no, this is a quote, we have no explanation for why the Portsmouth Police Department or the Portsmouth Police Commission did not intervene during the 2011-2012 timeframe. Just Monday night at the City Council meeting, Councilor Shaheen stated the following, I don't think this was a mishap. This was one of the most egregious violations of public trust in the city's history. I've talked to officers who say they want it behind them. It's tainting the department. It is time to act. Councilor Shaheen. Back in September of 2012, Chief DuBois told the Portsmouth Herald in writing that the department thoroughly investigated the situation and determined Goodwin broke no law or rules. However, the three volunteers of the Roberts panel were able to find six violations, some potentially criminal in nature. Chief DuBois, who was second in command, or the chief throughout this entire five-year debacle, it's actually 4 years, 10 months, we came back from a vacation, family vacation in August of 2010, and John Connors, who can't speak today because he's under an illegal unconstitutional gag order, cannot speak and hasn't been able to speak for over a year and a half now. He told us what was going on back in August of 2010. So Chief DuBois told Foster's nearly 2 weeks ago, we certainly know much more in 2015 than we did in 2012. Please tell the citizens of Portsmouth what you and the commission have specifically learned since 2012 that explains why you did nothing to stop Goodwin from taking more than $1 million that would have gone to the city. If you can't provide answers, it's time to resign. Or it's time for the police commission to step up, represent the good cities of Portsmouth, and do its job. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Next is Robert Snover.
Thank you, Robert Snover, 60 TJ Gamester Ave in Portsmouth. I'm gonna start by reading a letter from Jim Splain, who asked me to read this because he could not be here, to the Portsmouth Police Commissioners. I am unable to attend Wednesday evening's forum due to a long planned commitment, but I have asked a friend to offer my brief comments, which make 2 points. First, I want to emphasize that I have been deeply involved with the matter of the Weber estate and the way it has been mishandled during the past year. It has been my observation that almost all of the employees of our police department are excellent public servants. While it seems clear that this matter has shaken public confidence in the operations of the department, I am confident that the people of Portsmouth still know that a majority of those who serve as officers and rank and file employees do so with dedication, competence, and good intent. Second, we should all remember that this was a police officer, John Connor, who stood up and spoke about the potential wrongdoing almost 5 years ago at personal and professional risk. This very good man, whom I have gone to high school with, has been illustrative of good citizenship's 101. And if we had such an award, I'd nominate him for Portsmouth Profile in Courage. One step the police commission could do is to apologize to John Connors for the restraining order that has been issued some months ago to silence him and remove that constraint. In a democracy, as a community, we need more public servants like John Connors. Whether he is called a whistleblower or just a voice in the wilderness warning of something that seemed wrong but needed attention and correction, John Connor, often quietly, then at times not so quietly, gave us a warning that needed to be heard. Now that we have begun to respond to his call to action, we should let him know our thanks and appreciation. He and his wife Diane and neighbors Jane Zill and Joe Inosco became a courageous team that won't ignore wrong when they saw it. Thank you, Jim Suplain, Portsmouth City Councilor. And I would like to say personally, I agree with everything Jim has said here, and I have found it incomprehensible that so little has been done for so long by both the senior management of the Portsmouth Police Department and the commission. I'm glad that the city council has recognized, as well as this group, that the wheels are off here and something needs to be done. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. I'll take it. Yeah, thank you.
Give that to the clerk.
Next up is Michael Franzel.
Michael Franzel, 404 Union Street. Commissioners, Chief, this whole debacle has just been awful. I don't quite understand where, you know, you guys are volunteers on the commission, so I'm not casting aspersions at you as people or commissioners, but where has the commission been when somebody went lawyer shopping for somebody who has dementia, incompetent, and thereby gypped the city out of $1,300,000, including half of that to the police department? I think this could not have happened if we did not have a police commission, if the police department were treated as a regular city department under the city manager. I think the police commission has really outlived its usefulness. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Suzanne Ford.
I will just make this very quick. I've been following in the newspaper the articles in the Portsmouth Herald, and frankly, it's mind-boggling what has happened. The lack of management in the Portsmouth Police Department is, like I said, is mind-boggling. The command section has just basically violated their own management and guidelines. The police commission, I wonder really what is supposed to be expected of the police commission. The police commission, it appears, has a very personal alliance with the management of the police department. That's fine, being friends or so on and so forth. But when something is wrong and the police commission cannot cut their personal alliances with a management who is basically in your face wrong, then what's going on? Ms. Kavanaugh, I read your article, and I agree exactly. What has been going on in the Portsmouth Police Department for a long time that has allowed this to happen? I know the police work very closely together, there's personal relationships, but the whole thing is to have basically the chief of police overseeing a gentleman, a policeman, who is obviously not following protocol, and even stated when he was in court his personal relationship. So how many personal relationships have been going on all this time? There cannot be guidance and management, and then having personal relationships on the side. And when something comes that someone is doing something wrong, and as he was referred to in the newspaper as a rogue cop, whatever he is or not, that's beside the point. But the whole thing is, I'm wondering now, is the police commission, are you, as a police commission, are able now to really manage what has been a fiasco, a terrible situation. And I do feel sorry for the rank and file policemen and policewomen who go about doing their jobs in the midst of all this chaos. This should never have happened. It should have been nipped in the bud right from the beginning. And all due respect to Mr. Connors, I mean, a retired policeman with all kinds of, I'm sure, things that have, credit to him. He has trying to, whatever you call whistleblower, which I hate that term whistleblower. I think it's demeaning and degrading to anybody who sees something wrong and reports it and then gets whistleblower, and then they have to, back up and not say anything anymore? That's going to keep anybody else who sees something wrong in any aspect, whether it's the city council doing something wrong, whatever. But who's going to go and step forward after being demeaned like Mr. Connors has? And I think if the commission has not rescinded his not being able to publicly speak or whatever, I think that needs to be done. And all due respect, I'm sorry to say, but I think you as the commission dropped the ball. And from reading some of the article, Ms. Kavanaugh said, I think you perhaps have some personal relationships yourself with the manager of the police department, and how can you stand back and really focus and do your job like you're supposed to do? So.
Thank you, Suzanne. Next is Bruce Osborne.
Bruce Osborne, Tuweco Ave, Portsmouth, New Hampshire. I think it's totally embarrassing for the city of Portsmouth to be going through this. I think that the police department and the upper management dropped the ball. What they should have done when they found out what Goodwin was doing, brought him in the office and said, well, this is great for you. You've got two choices. Resign from the police department or stay away from Mrs. Webster. And they didn't do it. So I think anyone that's got their fingerprint on this action should resign, or at least put their letter in and let the city council decide if they want to keep them. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bruce. Next is Darcy Davidson.
Darcy Davidson, 60 TJ Gamester Avenue, Portsmouth. Thank you for holding this. I appreciate your volunteerism and your time tonight. And basically, to address some of what we've seen in the paper, I think now is not the time to circle the wagons. I think the time now is to right the wrongs, to bring the police department up, as suggested, to a national standard, and to ensure that all of the department understands all the codes and manuals, and that they observe them, and it is intimately used in day-to-day decisions, that the police resources are evenly distributed and accessed by the entire community and not a favored few, and that our mission is not to allow police officers to make somebody happy at the moment. It is community policing ought to be considered for the good of the community, taking the long view, and not just here in the moment trying to make one woman who is age-related, has age-related problems and dementia, to mistakenly and misguidedly cut loose her support system of her neighbors and friends based on the fact that she receives so much attention from a police officer that was charming and misguided in trying to make that person happy. So one of the things I ask is that you consider, when appointing or selecting a new deputy police chief, to find somebody who has not been tainted by this matter. Find somebody, a candidate that will help the department move forward, that will help the police chief in any way it can to help this community heal and adhere to professional standards. And I appreciate your consideration and all the work that you have done throughout this whole process. Thank you.
Thank you, Darcy. Maureen Foster.
Hi, good afternoon. I am here just to lend my support to the many eloquent and informed voices that speak here today. And also to say that, you know, we may feel this issue may seem, certainly doesn't seem as complex to me as probably it does to you, and you have more information, certainly. But it appears to me that we may feel that perhaps Officer Goodwin was misguided, that he was given bad advice, that he was young. There are so many things that we might think about this, but in the end, he was an adult, and he was able to think about what was morally right. He was able to read the ordinances and the codes of conduct by himself, as were the chiefs of police who advised him wrongly. And so because of that, in the end, we have to hold him responsible. I don't know of any other situation in which we say that ignorance might be an excuse for bad behavior. So just to sort of reiterate that, and to say also that we need to have a strong response to this. We cannot just shuffle our administrative codes a bit. We cannot edit things a little and then leave the people who created the situation still in the department. Thank you.
Thank you, Maureen. Bob Graham.
First of all, thank you, Commission, for holding this. I'm sure everybody behind me really appreciates this. One thing that I just don't get flat out, really, is the inherent and apparent and obvious conflict of interest. Three things. 90-something visits from Goodwin to Weber's house in a police cruiser in uniform. Multiple trips to local bars, whether in uniform or not. It's just wrong. Multiple visits to the bank to instruct banking personnel to have access to her folders because he's a cop in uniform. It's just wrong. I've been a builder in this community for 25 years, and if I see one of my guys putting on a clapboard that's obviously very, very crooked, I'm going to look at him and I'm saying, what do you think? It's just that simple. It really is. Unless he's 15 years old, he knows what the difference is between right and wrong. I really feel bad for John Connors. I think this police commission or somebody ought to lift his gag order. It's unconscionable to me why he's gagged. Maybe we don't have any whistleblower protection laws, but if we don't, we should. I know a lot of the local PD in this community, and I've talked with them recently, and all of them have morale problems. And I think what should happen is if the police commission cannot fire the three people that are directly supervising Aaron Goodwin, then maybe the police commission ought to think about not being a police commission anymore and having the police department fall under the city council like other departments do. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. George Dempsey.
Good evening, George Dempsey, 42 Dennett Street. Commissioner Gollum, you know what was missing from your opening introduction? You never mentioned Geraldine Weber's name. You folks don't mention her name. This is why you're here, because of Geraldine Weber, a decent human being who was manipulated, abused, go right down the line. I'm going to read to you elder abuse, the law. Nobody in this police department has ever been charged. If you go to the first statement, it goes like this: the commissioner on his or her authorized representative shall refer all cases of serious bodily injury to an incapacitated adult known or suspected to be the result of abuse, neglect, or exploitation. What's up, folks? There's no charge. Where's the crime? There's no crime here? Are you kidding me? With all you know now, you've never charged anybody. So people in this room know where I'm coming from. At the last three city council meetings, I've asked the mayor to demand your resignation, Jerry Howe's resignation, and Chief Du Bois, okay? You're not leadership. This is ridiculous. And you mentioned the Roberts report to stick to it. Well, guess what the Roberts report said? Get rid of you folks. Why? You're not doing your damn job. You have other issues that have gone on here. You had a woman go through that woman's property the day she died. No charge has ever been done. None. But property was removed. It's been validated. We have two different things going on here. We have a civil case, and we have what you're supposed to be doing. Now do us all a favor. Resign, because you don't cut it. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Eric Anderson.
Good evening. My name's Eric Anderson, 38 Georges Terrace, Portsmouth. I don't know where to begin. The amount of, you know, comments this and the amount of information have been just tremendous in this. They've been, I think it's been a lot of intelligent, a lot of intelligent comments, a lot of intelligent editorials. I commend Commissioner Kavanaugh for the, at least what I read in the local newspaper, for her frustrations in the commission. And I'm not sure that there's an adequate amount of transparency in this whole thing. In some cases, in some sense, I don't know what to comment on this evening because of the Roberts report, and there are criminal, you know, implications. There's ethical, and how are we able to comment on what we feel should be done and what your job is? If this type of meeting had taken place 2 or 3 years ago, we call it maybe a rush to judgment. But enough time has transpired. This thing did not even pass the straight-faced test when it was initially exposed. It's even become more, the controversy's become just incredibly intense. And call it a matter, call it an incident, whatever. It's an embarrassment. I tried to think of other words, and that word doesn't do justice to this particular issue. You have a job to do. The implications out of the Roberts report have criminal implications, have a variety of things that you as a commission should do. And it's about time that you do it. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. We mentioned that we would do a second round. Is there anybody that would like to come forward that hasn't spoken before? Would you please approach the podium?
My name is Paul McEachran. I live on Dennett Street. I came in after the word got out that you had to sign up, so I'll keep it brief, although I could go on for a long time. I want to tell you my own personal experience when I first heard John Connors come to my office. He told me what was going on, that he told the chief, told the assistant chief, he told a former commissioner who was a commissioner at the time, what he was seeing next door that he was observing. And my reaction was, why me? Why, why do I have to hear this? It happened to me once before in my lifetime, not anything to do with the city of Portsmouth. And I knew that as a citizen, I had to do something about it. And I made one promise to him and to the heirs of the 09 will. I said, we may not win this case, but I assure you we're going to get the facts out. And anybody that listened to the court case or read the depositions would know that the facts are all out there. And I could go into them, and I may touch on one or two of them. But I went back to the city charter, and I read the charter as it applies to the commission. And it's only 2 pages in the charter. And under powers of the commission, it says, the commission shall have the authority to consider and act upon any complaint and or employee grievances brought to it through such procedures where the commission determines there is sufficient cause. The commission may, after hearing, consistent with the requirements of due process, discipline or remove any employee of the police department against whom such a complaint has been brought. Now, we all know that Attorney Rizzo brought a complaint. As far as I know, you guys never heard it. And the powers, I know I'm getting to the 3 minutes, and I'll sit down. The commission shall assume all administrative responsibilities which would otherwise be vested in the city manager under the charter relating to the administration of the department. The buck stops with the commission. And as the Roberts report says, you guys didn't do your job. And I knew when I heard the story from John Connors that one cop couldn't pull this off. That it had to have the support or at least knowing indifference of the command staff. And if you guys didn't realize what was going on, something is wrong with the commission. And among the actions that you consider, you should consider resigning the commissioners who were in place when this occurred. That would be an honorable thing to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul.
Good evening. My name is Bill Downey. I live at Bow Street in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. This, to me, is probably the most egregious violation of public trust in my 28 years of residence here. I think the Roberts report was fairly accurate, but I disagree with the idea that this was benevolent policing, community policing, I believe is the phrase. I think this is about as obvious as climate change, even though there's a lot of deniers. But I think in order to restore the good name of the police force and the public trust, there must be substantial changes made. And unfortunately, we can't do it as democracy. It comes down to you, you three. But I hope you hear that, and I appreciate the time. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill.
Kathleen Logan, 21 Blossom Street. I'm not going to repeat all the things that were said, the statements that came before me, but I do think that this is a clear case of elder abuse, and I stated this when I spoke before the police commission several months ago. And I really would like to know where the Attorney General's office is in all of this. I'd feel a lot better if I knew that they actually had some role in this. As a matter of fact, I think there should be somebody from the Attorney General's office here tonight. But, you know, this is really frustrating for me and for a lot of other people because it seems like a one-way street. We get up here, say what we have to say, and we get really nothing back. And I think it's time that this all blows open and we start getting some answers. I called the police commission once several weeks ago as well, and I was told the same thing that you said tonight, which is that we don't know everything, we don't have all the information. Oh, I don't know, I think it's high past time that we got all the information. If indeed there's things that we don't know, we need to know them now. That's all I have to say, thanks.
Mark Brighton, 285 Union Street. Two things. As a community, do not get rid of the police commission. If anyone thinks that this couldn't have happened with the city council, you are sadly mistaken. Secondly, I would like to make a suggestion, and that would be that, Chief Dubois, Officer Schwartz and Officer Goodwin be put on paid administrative leave for 2 weeks or a month. No contact in the police station, no contact with you three. We need to get rid of the perception, and I'm using the word perception, Chief, of a personal influence. And I think that's the only way we can do it. It'd give time for you three people to get clear heads and decide what needs to be done.
Thank you, Mark.
Hello, I'm Bradford Bird of 184 Walker Bungalow. I live across the street from the Weber estate. And during the summers of 2011 and 10 there, when I saw like cop cars on a regular basis, I thought that Jerry had a problem and was like being a serial 911 caller. And then I saw people show up in like Jeeps and coolers and extra boats on her dock, and the whole impression I got was nobody's minding the store. Because how is it that all these people have suddenly made friends with Jerry Weber, who is not an easy person to make friends with, having lived across from her for 13 years? Just catching up on the news and reading the recent Roberts report, the realization is that not minding the store goes at many levels in the city government, and we need to restore some trust with the people that when something comes to our attention that is just so clearly laid out, that it was like clear as day. I've seen Jerry run over her mailbox 15 times and drag it all the way to the end of the street to come back to her house. She's not all there. And you know, we've just got to take some action and put away the idea that the public perception and we don't want this unwanted attention on the town or any, you know, bad thing. We just need to get at the truth, and then we'll worry about damage control later. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bob Hassel, 15 Mount Vernon Street in Portsmouth. I think when this evening is over, all these people sitting behind me want to see action. They don't want any more words. They want things done quickly. And it must be done because we're sick and tired of hearing all this gobbledygook. And it's up to you people to do something and do it fast.
Thank you, Bob. I said thank you, Bob. Is there anybody else that hasn't had? Okay, please come forward to the podium.
Hi, I'm Leslie McCarthy, 529 Union Street. I just can talk to you about what I know about my mother. My mother was worried about memory loss as she got older, so I spent a lot of time with her and elder people. The things that elderly do is they often accuse people of stealing or theft or burglars, or they give away everything to everybody who comes to see them. or they have no filter, or they don't remember who you are. I just wonder, places where my mother went to and lived in, there were rules. None of the staff could receive anything from people that live there. Why do you think they had those rules? That happens when you're old. Somebody wasn't watching this woman and wasn't watching from way back, 2011. Somebody should have said, this isn't right. Part of the way I equate it to is, it's kind of like the heads of parish taking advantage of the congregants. We all know it's wrong. So something's wrong. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Lenore Weiss-Bronson. I live at 828 Woodbury Avenue. I also took care of two parents, elderly parents who had dementia, and am very aware of how vulnerable people in that state are. Before anyone resigns, I think it's important that someone approach the state legislature and see that an RSA, a statute, be established that somehow addresses this problem. I don't know exactly what the details of it would be, obviously, but I think all attorneys, all healthcare workers, especially visiting nurses, all hospice workers, and everyone who applies for Medicare or Medicaid, as well as medical doctors and hospital workers, should be aware of this, what one think would be an obvious possibility or occurrence. I think we can't take for granted that everyone has the best interests of the elderly in mind. And unfortunately, we have to think in terms of maybe even making some sort of law or statute that addresses this. And I would appeal to you to please, in some way, put that into a recommendation that goes to the legislature. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jim Rizzo. I was Jerry's attorney for about 30 years. I represented Geraldine, her mother, and her son. And Jerry was very proud of her will. She was very proud of the charities that she had. The will remained consistent over the years. She was going to give to Shriners Burn. She was going to give to Sloan Kettering. And she wanted the city to have a large portion of it for safety equipment. She was very clear. In fact, John Connors told her, you cannot give to an individual. You can give to the department. And that's why in the will of 09 that I drew up for her, it was for safety equipment only. No individual was going to benefit by it. Now, when this happened in 2010 and 11, Captain Schwartz went to the Attorney General and filed a false report against me. And I was barred from dealing with Geraldine. That was later found to be unfounded, and the restriction was lifted. So Aaron had help on this. He had a scheme, he had a plan, get me out of the picture, and he could move in and take over. Barbara Wardwell is here. She took care of Geraldine over the years. She was cut out, as was Gaina Thomas of Newington. She was cut out. So what Aaron did is he isolated her from us. Now I told John Russo, who was a former commissioner, what was going on, and his comment was, good for Aaron. I talked to Bill Mortimer at one point, and Bill says, I wish I could have got away with that. So the attitude of the police commission was not good at the time. They wanted to help Aaron, and Aaron almost got away with it. Now, you don't have to resign. I think the election process will take care of itself. But you've got to do something. I don't know whether the commission should stay in effect or not. I've had police commissioners in the family over the years. And the commissions that they had were very good. I know Ruth was on one, as well as my grandfather, my great-grandfather. But they also had a very strong leadership in the Marshal Stanton Remick and other people on the in the police department. So they were able to keep things under control. We've had Bill Burke, and he did a great job too. I don't have a problem with Chief Dubois at this point. I think he realizes what went on, and I think he's trying to help us now. Maybe too little too late, but Aaron may or may not get the money. It's up to the court up in Stratford County. The right thing for him to do is not take the funds. Let it go back to the city and go back to the charities. And it will be a lot less than it was before because an awful lot of attorney fees have come out of this. But as I said, you have to stop the bleeding at some point and move on. Aaron should not benefit by this. And that's the reason why the settlement did not go. He did not have any right to $425,000, and everybody realized that. So I hope the commission does something. And again, if you don't resign, the election will take care of itself. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Is there anybody else that hasn't had a first chance to speak? I'm going to open it up for a second round, and then we're going to close the public comment session.
Again, Joe Nosco, 27 Shaw Road. I watched all this unfold across the street from Jerry. And I have no desire to do this. This has become, I started this when I was 54 years old. I'll be 60 years old in November. This has been a long haul. And one of the primary reasons I'm involved in this is I have two teenage boys that I'm trying to raise appropriately, properly, with respect for the law. And they, of course, heard what was going on. John would stop by, tell us about it. We'd see the cop cars. I called it the greatest Easter egg hunt in the history of Portsmouth as they went over and took turns pulling out between the $40,000 and $200,000 in cash she always kept in her house. Her best friends, some of them wouldn't even go into the house because they were afraid that she might accuse them of taking the money that she threw, that she showed around in wads. So I don't care to do this. Let's put an end to it. It's quite possible the election will prevent the commissioners from staying on this panel, and it would be a very sad way to go out. You can go out with honor by doing the right thing. Finally, I want to mention it's 2015. It's been 800 years since the Magna Carta was written. All across the globe in democratic societies, we are taking great pride and honor in the fact that people 800 years ago wrote a document that prevented anyone from being above the law. We have got soldiers fighting ISIS, other sacred and religious organizations and totalitarian secular groups that have no respect for the law or individuals. It's time to step up and apply the rule of law that we have here in this great democracy. Our Constitution is one of the great ones of the world. It is the first one, 1789. BC and AD, it's before the Constitution and after the document. This is what this is about, and this is what drives me here. This isn't a little game for any of us. It's a commitment to the rule of law. We have nothing else. Read your history. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe.
Jane Zill again. Referring back to the Roberts panel, the Roberts panel referenced that the first contact Goodwin had with the Weber was, I believe, in October of 2010. That is not correct. He had contact with her in August, I'm sure of it. The weather was beautiful. I saw so many police cars go back and forth to the Weber house that it reminded me of the Memorial Day parade in Flagler Beach, Florida. I also want you to know that the Roberts report did not commend John Connors, and he certainly deserves to be commended for all he's gone through, including as should his wife, Diane. as should Weber's good friend, Barbara Wardwell. Because they are the people who brought this forward, and it was not easy for them. And it was so difficult. We're all concerned about John Connors being sanctioned by his department as a whistleblower. Guess what? You know what really made me furious? What really convinced me there was something wrong? In 2011, he learned that he was the subject of an investigation by the AG's office for stalking Weber. What? That is outrageous, and it was a clue to me that there was a systemic, planned operation here to allow Goodwin and whoever else to become the beneficiary of that multi-million dollar estate, and it was totally in disregard for who might get hurt, including Weber's disabled grandson, her elderly good friends, and Weber herself. As one of the neighbors said, Weber was a very difficult person to get along with. In her last years, this lady with dementia was able to finally, after being divorced in 2006, establish a support system that was regular and routine, where she got to go out for lunch every Friday. After going to the doctor, Barbara took her out for lunch. She had a housekeeper who was loyal to her and took care of her for years. She had a former daughter-in-law call her every Sunday. She had a friend come and take her to bingo every Sunday. It all went away. That is a horrible way for a person to die. She died alone after having horrible relationships her own life. She finally achieved something, and it was destroyed by a Portsmouth police officer. I think it is just absolutely heartbreaking and appalling.
Thank you, Jane.
Michael Franzel, I still live at 404 Union Street. To follow up on what Jane said about Goodwin destroying Weber, one of the strangest things about this is while it was all going on, Officer Goodwin got promoted. Seems a little strange to me, guys. I don't understand how that could possibly happen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Arthur Clow, whenever somebody takes a position like commissioner, they swear an oath to defend the Constitution. The Constitution has civil rights protected, especially for the weak. The Constitution protects people from sexual harassment in the workplace. It protects disabled people, for example, somebody that has dementia. And it gives us the right to come up and petition our government for redress against grievances. And that's why we're here, and I'm glad that broader comments are being made. There's a history of not caring too much about the Constitution or about the law in decisions that the department made, and they are enabling. I spoke earlier about the history of sexual harassment, sexual misconduct in the department. The only time that ever, that I know of, resulted in the ejection of anybody was when criminal charges were filed by the state police. But you had a recent settlement, not too long, 2 years ago. You had a recent settlement and the person still continued to go up within the department. That's pretty scary. You had an officer using the field house at the high school as a hookup shack. And the public never became aware of it. Somebody with access to children.
Arthur, I don't want to do this to you again, but this is not the Roberts Report, please.
This is...
I've respected everybody here. Respect this process, please. This has nothing to do with the Roberts Report. And if you continue, I will gavel you down.
The Roberts...
I won't let him talk if it's not for the Roberts Report.
I can frame it. I'm clever enough to do that.
Well,
the Roberts Report... You're interrupting
it.
Me.
Thank you, Arthur.
I request my 30 seconds back from that. I understand. The Roberts Report shows a history of inaction. That's what I'm talking about. And when there was an introduction made to this, there was a claim made by you yourself that the department doesn't have a history of misconduct. So I'm addressing your remarks at the beginning of the meeting. It's your invitation. But there has been no legal action taken against the perpetrators, the enablers. John Connors was cited for malfeasance. Well, I think malfeasance is misappropriation of funds as well. And to have money taken away by a city employee from the city is certainly a misconduct that falls under the realm of egregious behavior. Enabling it is called aiding and abetting. These are all terms that I think the police should know. And in closing, one of the things that I would like to say is that your haircuts gave you away. I see a lot of good officers over here. We appreciate your attendance. We appreciate your work. We are not blaming you for what happened. We are putting the blame where the Roberts Report puts it, on the command staff, Du Bois, McDonald, and Schwartz.
Thank you, Arthur. I'm calling the public meeting closed. Paul, you made it under the gavel. I apologize. I don't have peripheral vision. All right. Sorry about that.
Paul McEachran, Dennis Street. Just 2 points, 2 facts that you may not be aware of. The command staff was aware that the prior will of Geraldine Weber left one half of her estate to the city of Portsmouth on February 1, 2011. That's in the transcript of the meeting at the Bureau of Adult and Elderly Services in Portsmouth, an interview with Geraldine Weber at which Captain Schwartz was present. And at that same interview, Captain Schwartz indicated that Goodwin and Weber met sometime in the summertime. The other point is that the Chief Ferlin, who testified in court, that he didn't learn about the bequest until it was in the newspapers, until after she died. He was interviewed by that same Bureau of Adult and Elderly Services on April 11th, 2012. Deborah Gendron and Mike Kowalski interviewed him and told him about the charge that Goodwin was receiving everything under her will. Deborah Gendron's testimony was recorded at a deposition, and I'll read you part of page 24. And this is the questioner, David Eby, talking. Question, and what was Chief Ferlin's reaction when Mr. Kozlowski started talking to him about the issue of taking everything through a will of Geraldine Weber? Her answer, meaning, question, receiving money or something through a will. That's the point of what he was discussing, right? The answer was, right. Well, we wondered, and this is Deborah Gendron from the state talking, we wondered if we could see a copy of the police code of ethics just to see what it exactly said in there about affiliating with citizens privately or on the job. And at the time, the chief wouldn't give us a copy because I recall him saying that he thought we might misinterpret it, the code of conduct of ethics. But as it says here, he said, if you have a founded report, he wanted to investigate and take immediate action. That's what he told us. The purpose was mainly to get a copy of the Code of Ethics, the police code of ethics, or a general code of conduct, as he put it. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Seeing nobody come forward, I'm going to call the public meeting closed. Thank you for coming. I'll entertain a motion for a 5-minute recess.
I move that we take a 5-minute recess.
Second. We're recessed. Good evening. We're back live. I've already opened up the meeting. I will like to ask Commissioner Howe if he would lead us in a moment of silence and followed by the pledge.
Hang out in the Portsmouth room. She's going to ask them to go on the other room. Is that right?
I don't think our mic is fine. I don't think our mics are.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Commissioner Howe.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the minutes of the May 20th Portsmouth Police Commission meeting.
I second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. I think we're going to go right to item B, I believe. I'm going to turn it over to you, Chief.
Stand by. We get to the.
Will do.
Oh, here we go. We have a grant application that we are making and just wanted to. Let you know about this. So it's under the terms of the 215 Justice Assistant Grant application. The police department is required to publicly announce a grant application is being submitted in the amount of $10,182 to fund the development and purchase as needed of a personnel evaluation and development tool. Of that money, $509 will go to Rockham County as an administrative fee for their acting as a fiscal agent for this grant. And this agenda item serves to satisfy the terms of public advisement required by the grant application, and no further action by the police commission is required.
Thank you, Chief.
Unless, would you like me to turn over to Karen to talk about money?
I thought that would be great. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
We're 92% through the fiscal year, and we're currently tracking at 88.5%. Within that expenditure, the overtime is 100% expended at this point, mainly because of the dispatcher situation that we had. I'm sure the chief can speak to the fact that we finally have three dispatchers hired. They're going to be starting.
Yeah, we got two that are, I think they're already in training, and then one other is going to be delayed a couple weeks so that they have enough buffer for the training purposes, because I don't have a lot of dispatchers for that. So
we should be up to staffing probably, I think, beginning or end of fall.
Yes.
By the time they get out of training. So hopefully, as we're progressing through the new fiscal year, overtime should level out at that point. In terms of the end of the fiscal year, we're not there yet, but we do show a surplus. And as was discussed, the council approved us for $25,000 in the new fiscal year budget, but we still had $20,000 that we needed to finish with the cold case project. So out of this fiscal year, I've spoken with the finance department of how we're going to track that, but we're going to encumber the monies for the physical and fingerprint evidence costs, and we're getting quotes on that as we speak, so that should actually start before the end of June. And then the other thing that we're looking at is tasers, because our tasers, I think, are 10 years old.
And yeah, our tasers, the company that makes them, they're starting to move on to a different model, so they're gonna at some point stop supporting the models that we have. So because of their expenses, we want to start purchasing them so we can do it over a period of time.
Kind of like a rolling stock, and then we'll kind of maintain that momentum.
Yep.
And Officer Sheldon is also checking out that the company that sells the tasers offers up some sort of I want to say service maintenance agreement kind of thing, where when new models come out in 5 years or whatever, if we work with this service maintenance agreement, then we don't have to have the major expense every 10 years,
sure.
That they'll be able to replace them after every 5 years. So it might be something to help keep our budget smooth instead of spiking, having to replace this equipment. So we'll report back to you on that.
Thanks,
as a possible option.
Karen, how's gasoline tracking? I know it's getting, I see it high at the pump, so how are we doing?
We're still tracking fine. I don't know if it's our new SUVs or what, but we're tracking really well in our gasoline line. Yep.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions for Karen? I think Commissioner Cavanaugh, I'm going to turn over to you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Just a couple of announcements. I am really excited to announce that the Police Commission joined the National Association for Civilian Oversight in April. So the commission is now a organizational member of the Civilian Oversight Law Enforcement Board. What this allows us to access includes information regarding best practices, provide technical assistance to new and existing oversight agencies. There's a lot of resources available to the commission to assist us with our commitment to civilian oversight and to strengthen our current commission into a truly world-class commission as being part of this board. Now, you don't have to be on a police commission to be a member of NACOL. It is available for regular members, associate members, or student members. You don't have to be sworn law enforcement or an elected official. It's a really valuable resource, and I encourage people to look up the NACOL website. Secondly, I am very encouraged about the news that Chief provided us earlier with moving forward in the accreditation process. Chief's been in communication with the Northern New England chapter head?
It's the gentleman that's in charge of this region, and he's already provided me the necessary documentation. And so what I'm gonna do is ask them to come up to do a presentation publicly to the commission. Hopefully they will try to schedule it for the commission meeting next month. If they can't do it for that time, we'll schedule another meeting that we can get you in front of them so that we can have a back and forth and just talk about the process.
Perfect.
And this is Kalia we're talking about, correct?
Yes. This is out of the Roberts report. One of the recommendations was to seek the accreditation process, and this is through Kalia. And so that is moving forward.
Excellent. Thank you.
You're welcome.
That's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Thank you, Commissioner.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to move that we accept the division and team reports and put one copy on file.
I second the motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Well, I just want to let everybody know the next scheduled police commission meeting is July 15th right here in Eileen Dondero Foley Council Chambers at 6 p.m. If there's no other business, I think I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we adjourn the June meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
We're adjourned.